So we go on to our fourth paper in this session, which is Aspect of Subtleness in the Learning Environment, going to be presented by Vaishali Borker, who's a freelancer. Vaishali?
Yes.
Can I share my screen?
Yes, you're audible. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you. I'm Vaishali Borker. I'm bachelor's in architecture and master's in industrial product design from IIT Bombay. When this topic of designing for children with focus on play and learn came about, the topic that interested me was the aspect of subtleness in learning environment. So I started with the hypothesis that exposed children to various environments, with the environment or study material being imposing or obvious, the children may gather maximum information. But if the environment is subtle, optimum impact may be achieved with immense possibilities for developing a more creative thinking individual. Play and learn or tell a story and learn itself is subtle. But taking subtlety further, my research focuses on illustrations used in storytelling. Now, one did not tell a moral to a child at the end of a story, as that defeats the purpose of learning. Similarly, could too many elaborate illustrations restrict the reader's imagination for exploring newer perspectives or thoughts? Could it end up like spoon feeding? Can subtle or suggestive illustrations help develop more creative thinking individuals? That is how I started. And the objective was to find and set guidelines to design the most beneficial illustrations for developing creative thinking individuals. However, can subtlety lead to a wrong or undesirable understanding? This was also the concern. And what was the degree of subtleness that was desirable? So the methodology followed was a single episode story was from the famous treatise Panchatantra was illustrated without any text in three ways. The first one was several frames, where each and every action of all the characters in the story were illustrated. The second was wherein only the sub-episodes within the story were illustrated. In this case, it amounted to four frames. And the last, it illustrated only the first frame and the last keyframe, the background providing for the continuity between the two, and one or two objects, in this case, a wedge provided the link between the two frames. I would have thought that this is too insufficient and would deliver the maximum amount of ambiguities. And perhaps the optimum number of frames could be somewhere four, where the sub-episodes have been illustrated. But to my surprise, it was the four-frame, the sub-episodes illustration that delivered the maximum number of ambiguities. As you'll see, the several frames was 11, four frames was 18, and two frames was 10. The perfect narration for all three types was more or less the same. Now, when was it considered as perfect narration was when the wedge is removed and the leg or the tail gets stuck in its place. The tail or the leg getting caught is a direct consequence of the removal of the wedge. All the rest came in half correct. The total sample size was 120 with the equal male, female, and urban rural ratio. The average time taken in minutes was also noted down. As you will see, the several and the two frames have taken more or less the same time, but the four frame illustration has taken the least amount of time but delivered maximum ambiguities. The average number of words for four frame and two frame was the same, whereas for the several type, it was about 17% higher. Now, one would wonder where were the ambiguities or where were the mistakes when all each and every action has been depicted. Well, it was seen that the tendency of the mind getting into a habitual mode of simply stating the actions without applying the mind. For example, the children started narrating what was there in the pictures, like one man was hitting a nail, another was digging the ground, a third one was carrying a sack. And similarly, they went on for the monkeys, like one monkey was sitting on a log, another jumped on a log, and a third monkey's tail got caught in the log. So they perceived multiple monkeys, and hence their story has gone totally astray. Still others, they narrated what the humans were doing, and then the monkeys tried to copy but fail. So there's no mention of the leg getting caught or anything. Now, was this distraction due to too many frames? And that is why they could not get the gist of the story. Now, some other observations. Two kids state that the wedge was placed as a trap to catch the monkeys. Now, whether to consider this as an ambiguity or a fresh interpretation was the question. But looking at the general narration and the moral stated at the end of the story, it was, in this case, included in ambiguity.
Now, the children were asked to write the model at the end of the story only to see whether, check for any ambiguities or just to check whether they have grasped the story or no. For example, if the moral was stated as mind your own business or do not copy others unless you know the work yourself, then it was considered as non-ambiguous. Whereas if the moral of the story was listen to your elders or something like that, which was like nothing connected to the story, or we should conserve our forests or something like that, then it was considered as ambiguous. This environmental concern seems to be there in all three types of illustration. But then in most of the cases, what is actually happening in the illustrations was not mentioned at all. In the four frames, the sub-episodes illustration, the ambiguities seem to be mainly because of ignoring of frames. If the last frame was ignored, the story has gone completely wrong. But in some cases, part of the last frame was ignored. For example, they say the monkey, the wedge fell on the head of the monkey and hence he was in pain. They have failed to notice that the tail has got stuck. Or in other cases, they mentioned that mistakenly the monkey hammers his own tail into the log. Or by unknowingly, the tail has entered the log. In which case, they have failed to notice the dislodged wedge. Five have mentioned pulling of wedge, but not the monkey being puzzled. So they have taken note of the third frame, but not of the second one. Only three out of the 15 who gave perfect narrations have mentioned both or taken note of both frame two and three. The rest seven practically have used only two frames, the first and the last, to get it right. In the two key frames illustration, the ambiguities didn't seem to have any particular trend. Like the monkeys attacked the carpenters to teach them a lesson. Here it was the environmental concern that since the carpenters were cutting the wood, cutting the trees, the monkeys attacked them to teach them a lesson. Now, monkeys challenged that he could cut the wood with his tail. One child had come up with this. Carpenters have kept mangoes and monkeys came to eat mangoes, etc. Two children very objectively have read both the illustrations correctly, but have failed to connect the two frames. Or two children describe frame one, but are unable to comprehend the frame two. In the two frames, the illustration, the in-between frames are not there, but they have been imagined as playing with the wedge, copying the carpenters, playing mischief, etc. Pulling the wedge hard has been narrated by most in spite of no frame being there illustrating, showing this action. In the two and four frames illustration, many variations were seen in the beginning of the story. There was also a tendency to name the characters like Rama, the woodcutter, went into the forest, or the temple of Shiva was being built, or in the village of Palampur, so and so. They are even trying to guess their profession or the reason to cut trees. For example, they stated they had no work and hence they thought they'll go to the forest, cut trees, sell the wood, and then and thus earn their livelihood. All these observations were not seen in the several frames. The children were also seen applying actual life experiences, like the tendency of the monkeys to copy humans is noted. Monkeys snatched food from carpenters, etc. So in conclusion, the key frame illustration gave same number of perfect and ambiguous narrations as several frames. Hence, we cannot conclude that subtlety has led to wrong understanding. In the two frame or the key frame illustration, the average number of words is about 17% less, negligible as compared to the difference in the number of frames, which was 5 times or 500%. The subtlety has certainly benefited children as they were compelled to use their imagination where there were no frames or illustrations. Thought given for the beginning of the story and other observations discussed show a clear advantage for the two or the key frames illustration. Thus, it is concluded that the key frames illustration was the most beneficial, where optimum impact was achieved for a more creative, imaginative output from children. My future studies would include to see if such processes can be repeated to bring about a change in total outlook or the psyche of an individual, of a child. And also to include other aspects of illustrations like color, number of elements, etc. Yes, thank you.
Oh, yeah. Thank you so much also to give more time for discussion. I'm waiting. I'm sure there will be some questions. In the meantime, I was just wondering about, you talk about subtlety and ambiguity a lot in the paper. So, I mean, but there is no definition as such which is given for both in terms of how you have used them. What are the factors which make it ambiguous and what makes it subtle?
Actually, the surrounding portion, I mean, whatever else they narrate in the story was their own imagination or their creativity. the ambiguity, see, whatever else they narrate, it was considered as their own imagination, their own interpretation. They could say anything. It could add or be deducted from whether it was totally unrelated to the illustrations or related to the illustrations. The only thing that was considered as non-ambiguous was that the wedge was removed and the tail gets stuck or the leg gets stuck. If they stated only these two things, it was considered as non-ambiguous. The rest of the story was this, they could state anything, they could write anything. And if they had not got these two elements, which were essence of the story actually, then it was considered as ambiguous. Now that we have to listen to our elders, how can that be related to the story? Because the monkey did not listen to his elder monkeys, and that is why he fell into trouble. So this was nowhere there in the illustration. So that was considered as ambiguous. Whereas even if everything else was according to their own imagination or whatever, as long as they got that the wedge was removed and the tail got stuck, it was considered as totally non-ambiguous, actually.
No, I was just, I thought a more general definition rather than a very specific related to the story and the illustration what I was hoping for. But I get the point. There is one question. So is this a case of less is more for children? What open-ended questions and designs help?
I was surprised with the conclusion. As I said, I was expecting the optimum level of frames to be more than the two. It could be where the sub episodes were illustrated, but I was surprised with the results where the two frames illustration gave the minimum number of ambiguities and the same number of perfect answers. And even the creativity, the imagination that somebody doesn't have a livelihood and hence he's going to the forest to cut wood so that he earns his livelihood by selling it and all. There were a lot of more thought gone into the two frame illustration. So as you said, two frames, or rather I would say the opposite, the several frames or the four frames were too much. And the two frames was like, even four frames was a lot for them. The two frames was just right where they gave the maximum, a very good output.
So did you try it with most stories or was this the...
Yes, this could be since the paper is long and I have a limited time, I had just put so much.
Have you done more?
Thinking started from what were our ancestors doing right that we were always leading in medicine, math, science, everything in the ancient times, whereas now we are not anywhere close because we're not thinking innovatively or we're not thinking creatively or independently. And what was the education system different and how can we improve so that we can be more creative? That is how I had started. So I would like to repeat many more experiments like this whereby the total outlook of a person can be changed.
I also see it, of course, you did it experiments with children, but I think it also helps visual designers, probably gives them cues as to how they can design better so that it brings about
how the illustrations output. Should be designed. So guidelines. So the second thing for my future studies would be how many elements to use or how many colors to use or things like that.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.